A petition at the University of Minnesota Morris calling for a campus-wide search for graves of possible boarding school students has exploded with more than 30,000 signatures and counting. So what happened there decades ago when it was the site of a Native American boarding school?
Chris Rapsky looks into a lost history more people are finally hearing about.
In the heart of the Morris campus, a stone sculpture overlooks the student traffic. It is an Anishinaabe grandmother, warm and resilient. A grandson in a boarding school uniform, terrified. A granddaughter clutching her grandma, hiding her face, resisting what's to come. It is a daily reminder of this property's painful past.
If you ask any Native American, did children die while at boarding schools? They've known for years that the answer was of course.
Yeah.
It's only a discovery to people who haven't thought about it before.
Janet Schrunk Erickson became acting chancellor of the University of Minnesota Morris 3 months ago. She is now trying to manage the reckoning of this site's history.
And the problem is that there really are not good records. We don't have detailed, certainly not objective, accounts of what happened at the time, nor do we have really accounts from the individuals who were at the schools.
Some 70 years before Morris became a state university, in 1887, Sister Mary Joseph, a Catholic nun, started the Morris Indian School with funding from the government. She recruited Native children from reservations in South and North Dakota and later across Minnesota, according to a report from historian Wilbert Ahern. Children received uniforms and haircuts, allowed to speak English only. Half the time was spent in the classroom and half learning agriculture and domestic work that partially funded the school. Ahern writes, quote, "The curriculum emphasized the value of the white man's way and at least implicitly the evil of the child's home."
Were parents made aware of what was happening inside the walls?
I believe not.
Gabriel DeRosier is a Morris alum.
And this one is midterm.
Now a professor of Anishinaabe language, song, and dance.
One of the main goals was to assimilate and exterminate the Indian within. The children were a target because they're the ones who are going to keep the traditions alive. So they targeted the children using education as a method of doing this.
The second chapter of the school appears much worse. The federal government bought and operated the school in 1896. Ahern writes, parents were lied to. Some children weren't allowed home for summer break, creating distrust among Native families. A typhoid outbreak killed one student and sickened 37 others. He writes, there were scandals and sexual improprieties between staff and students. Superintendent William Johnson was accused of raping two students and having an affair with a staff member. This all led to the school's closing in 1908 and the property given to the state of Minnesota under the condition that all future Indian students be admitted, quote, free of charge for tuition and on terms of equality with white pupils.
It is the only building that remains of the original Morris Industrial School.
Dylan Young is vice president of the Morris student body. His student office is located in what was once a dormitory for Native boarding school students.
I think that history makes me feel like there's a lot of work to be done.
The university says research from 2018 indicates there could be 2 to 7 children buried on or near the old boarding school campus.
A lot of names.
Dylan helped pen a petition urging the university to search.
This is a living, learning community. How can we expect students, especially our Indigenous students, to be able to completely focus on education and have that privilege to have a clear mind and focus solely on their studies if their relatives are buried underneath where they're supposed to be, going to class?
It affects you.
Emotionally, deeply, it does. Spiritually.
There's a student group that would like you and would like a while ago to start searching for these potential graves. Is that something you are willing to do? And if so, why not?
I'm completely willing to do it. But I think the question isn't if I am willing to do it. The question is this what our tribal nations want us to do?
While records show children died at the school, the university says there is no record indicating where children might have been buried.
None of those maps reference a cemetery, which makes it enormously challenging, and the ground has been significantly disturbed over time. So the...
It's a massive challenge.
It's a big challenge.
A challenge the university says they'll take on with direction from tribal leaders. A challenge students like Young will continue to push.
Fighting for the students that died on this campus so that they could be returned home and that their spirits can make their journey.
You carry that responsibility with you.
I think all of us should.
In recent weeks, the university received new high-quality maps with historic information, which means the university could begin searching the property next spring or summer.